Okay. Well, going back to last week's advert for the show, which was about the Akeda, this question is was basically stated. France Filiault, forgive me if I'm mispronouncing that name. Address Jesus. The whole Jesus is God plus the sacrifice of not only of Jesus but also of Abraham and Isaac. That whole situation was all voluntary, so therefore it couldn't have been. It couldn't have been a sacrifice per se, but they're saying too that the whole Akeda incident with Abraham and Isaac was a foretelling of the future sacrifice of Jesus. Can you offer some clarity on that and why that's not really possible or even plausible?
Yeah. Somebody asks a question, and it's hard to know where to begin. In Yiddish, it's said is Hadish Khan. It doesn't have any feet, and it doesn't have a tail, and doesn't have a head. It doesn't have a beginning. It doesn't have an end. I mean, maybe one should say that the Akeda is foretelling the Mayan human sacrifice of virgins. And if you don't believe me, you can go to Cozumel. You can go to the Great Reefs in Mexico and see that they brought 14-year-old girls for sacrifices. And the Akeda, the binding of Isaac, it would be so preposterous that I probably would get thrown out of Indonesia for making that suggestion. Human sacrifice is forbidden. It's an odious abomination. We could find it in virtually every idolatry in the world of human sacrifice. Christianity is the motherlode of all idolatry. Human sacrifice is the centerpiece of Christianity, except for the book of Luke. Whoever wrote Luke Acts did not believe in human sacrifice, but that author is an exception. Paul, this is what Christians believe. This is an abomination. This has nothing to do with Isaac, the binding of Isaac. If any religion proposes that a human being should be killed for the sins of others, get your running shoes on and run as fast as you can. Get your car and reverse out of your driveway, put your car in drive and just floor it. Get out of there as quickly as possible. Because the Bible tells us that this is an abomination to God. So I could just say that run as fast as you can. And you don't need to. There's any religion that says that you have to offer a person, a human being, an innocent human being, has to die to benefit sinful people. Which, I mean, imagine a country that adopted such a law. You know, recently Indonesia executed 8 drug dealers. And it's a very severe punishment in this country for dealing in drugs. Users are not executed, but drug dealers of the hard drugs are executed. It's controversial. But as it turns out, about 15,000 Indonesians each year die from drugs, from illicit drugs. So in this country, drug dealers are looked upon as serial killers. That's just the way this country is. Now, I am sure that many of the listeners disagree with this policy and feel that although people who traffic heroin should be thrown in prison, but maybe some people believe that they should not be executed. But it leaves, I think, Indonesia's policy, because this is such a horrible thing of nearly, let's say, about 40 Indonesians die. I mean, there's going to be Indonesians dying during this program from heroin and other hard drugs. But one thing that frightens this country is, God forbid, an innocent person might be executed, a person who had no idea that they were carrying drugs. But I mean, could you imagine if this country would take an innocent person who never did a drug, never carried a drug, and let the drug dealers go and execute that person instead? I mean, would that make any sense to anyone? So that's just completely nonsensical. This idea is not found, incidentally, in the Christian Bible. I mean, I would like any Christian who believes that Genesis 18 and 19, that Abraham, who was tested by God, was a foreshadowing of Jesus' death on the cross. This idea, if it really is so central to teachings of Christianity, did God just forget to mention this point? I mean, did God? I mean, that would have been, there are 23,000 passages in the Jewish Bible, and many of them are devoted to warning the Jews never to engage in human sacrifice, like Ezekiel chapter 18. I mean, if you read it for yourself, Ezekiel is going, where have I heard this rumor that the innocent could die for the sins of the wicked? This shall never be. And if the wicked repent of their own sins, God, I will forgive their sins completely. Their iniquity will no longer be remembered against you. That's Ezekiel 18, 21 through 23. Please look it up for yourself. But are we to believe that God just forgot to mention the most important thing? I mean, couldn't he have thrown in to Genesis 18 that my son is going to die, and this is a foreshadow? The answer is it isn't there. Why isn't there? Because this does not come from the mind of God. This is completely born in iniquity. This notion was born in sin. I have a surprise for you. If, in fact, the earliest Christians believed that Genesis 18 was a foreshadowing of Jesus' death, if that were the case, why isn't that even mentioned in the Christian Bible? It's not in the New Testament. That means no one thought of that. Why didn't Paul say that? That means Paul actually wanted, right now, he really would like you not to believe in Christianity because he doesn't want you to make the mistake that he made. So right now, we don't want to talk to him, but you know, but at the time, they were all advancing the idea of human sacrifice, with the exception of Luke. So why didn't Paul say that? That means that this didn't occur to any writer in the Christian Bible. This notion is a fabrication that was created by later writers, such as, it comes from writers such as the author, we don't know who it is, but the author of a forgery called the Epistle of Barnabas. It's a forgery. It was a very important forgery because in the early church, there are many Christians who believe that it really was written by Barnabas and it is the Word of God. It almost made it into the canon. I'm really glad it didn't because it's very anti-Jewish. If the New Testament is anti-Jewish, the Epistle of Barnabas was like a hydrogen bomb. If that thing ever made it into the New Testament, Jews would have to move to the North Pole. So, I mean, I just can't even, it's hard to imagine that Jewish-Christian relations could have been worse, but if books like the Gospel of Peter and the Epistle of Barnabas, not to be confused with the Gospel of Barnabas, that's very, very late. I don't know about the Epistle of Barnabas. So that idea is advanced there. It was advanced by a Catholic Church father, Justin, in the second century, that all these things in the Jewish Bible really will point to the future. But why is it even the New Testament? So no one, Paul doesn't believe this. Mark, the author of Mark, again, we don't know who wrote the book of Mark. We have no clue who wrote it. We have no idea where it was written. But whoever wrote it was conveying vicarious atonement, that an innocent person could be a human sacrifice for wicked people. Author of Mark believed that. Author of Matthew believed that. Luke Acts did not believe that. Luke Acts is a whole different theology. But the key point is, why isn't it in the New Testament? So this is a later Christian invention. It is an improvement. It is, when I say an improvement, I italicize that word. It was later introduced by a creative mind, just like the Holocaust deniers. The Holocaust denial began, let's say, The first Holocaust deniers were actually in the late 1950s, but it was considered ridiculous, but it became more and more sophisticated, and the claims became more elaborate in the 1970s and 1980s, where they had all kinds of fancy stupidities where the Holocaust never happened. But it did become more sophisticated later on as we marched away from the Shoah. So that this is not even in the Christian Bible. So what am I responding to? Well, then anything. So then what will, if I can make up anything I want to that's not in the Bible, then what religion could be dismissed? And aren't these Protestants who believe in sola scriptura, like only the Bible? Well, where is this parallelism in Scripture? It isn't there. But when I say to you that human sacrifice is forbidden, you can ask me, where does the Bible say that? And I can show you 500 passages say it explicitly. We all know them. It's an abomination. Run away from this kind of stuff. Okay, so that's really the answer. I mean, that's all nonsensical.
I'm going to play the devil's advocate for just a moment.
No. Play the angel's advocate. We got so many devils.
If you look at the devil doesn't need any help, right?
You go to Manhattan. On the east side of Manhattan, there's a big building. I think it's around 33rd Street. It's very, you can see it very easily because it's on right on the FDR Drive. And it's a huge, tall, thin building that goes up. That's the house of the devil. And that's the United Nations. That's they're doing great. The devil doesn't need your help.
Okay, here's the rule. Jesus is God, so it wasn't human sacrifice. You hear that a lot. I mean, I hear it a lot. I know you've heard it hundreds of times. Just, if you would, just lay out for the viewers what's the easiest way to quickly diffuse that and move on to the next topic.
If you are a Gnostic Christian, okay, that's fine. That will work. If you subscribe to an expression of Christianity called the Marcion movement that was flourished in the second century, I mean, that could work. And the reason is that Gnostic Christians believe that Jesus was never human, and that what happened was this deity, one of many deities, entered an ordinary guy, as it turned out, Jesus, and inhabited his body. But really, the God Jesus was never human. And the cult crucifixion really was just an appearance. Jesus appeared to be crucified, but it was an apparition. And that explains the cry of dereliction found in the book of Mark, where Jesus is on the cross saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? So Gnostic Christians explain this very easily and say, the guy who was crucified wasn't the deity Jesus at all. It was a guy whose body was inhabited. And then when the deity left his body, the guy is on the cross going, what the heck happened to me? If you are not a Gnostic Christian, this doesn't work. It doesn't work because Christians believe that Jesus was fully human. They don't believe that he was God and not human. The Gnostics did believe that. Marcion did believe that. But what is called Orthodox, lowercase o, did not believe that. So therefore, Christians subscribe to the notion that Jesus was absolutely, completely human. Now, the notion that he was a mode of God doesn't work because when it says you are my son in whom I am well pleased in the opening chapter of the book of Mark, who is God talking to? Was God saying I'm pleased with myself? I mean, this is completely preposterous. This makes Zeus worship look intelligent. So as it turns out, this is a false dichotomy. Christians do not believe that Jesus was just spirit and not human. They believe he was fully human. It's not that they believed it in the early days, but the improved version of Christianity that we encounter today is not Gnostic Christianity. All mainstream Christians today believe that Jesus was fully human and his divinity did not mitigate or take away or diminish from his humanity. So it's just simply inaccurate to say that. It's just not true. None of this all works is because obviously the earliest Christians never believed that Jesus was God. That is a later Christian development. It's a later Christian invention. And of course, but the problem for the church was when it had introduced the notion Jesus was God, there was a problem. And that is, if Jesus is God and the Father is God, that means you have two gods. The Christians were stuck. And the stuck problem is they had the Jewish Bible that said there is one God and there is no one else. Now, Gnostics and those who adhere to the teachings of Marcion, again, mid-second century, they didn't have a problem with that because they didn't believe in the Jewish Bible. Marcion believed that the God of the Jewish Bible was a completely different God than the God of the Christian Bible. And therefore, there were two gods, different gods, and therefore he didn't care about the God who created the world of the Jews, because that God was a tough God, and the God of Jesus was the God of grace and love. The Gnostics believed further than that. Gnostics believed that the God who created the world, the God of the Jews, was an evil deity, a bad God, and that they couldn't give a hoot about any statements that there is one God. So for them, this was not a problem. They can have Jesus as a God. Everybody can be gods. Gnostics believed all Gnostics were pagans. Not all Gnostics were Christians, but all Christian Gnostic Christians. Gnostic comes from the Greek word gnosis, which means knowledge. And what does knowledge mean? Like, what does that mean, knowledge? Well, knowledge means that you came to this evil world, this very evil world, I'm not going to go into it, and basically you needed knowledge to know who you were, how you got here, and most importantly, how to escape this very evil world, this material world that was created by the evil God of the Jews. And therefore there were many deities, Jesus included, who came to impart knowledge how to escape this world. That's all I'm going to go into. This is much more elaborate than that, but that's it. So this doesn't work. Nothing works. It doesn't work because it's like Nixon and the Watergate tapes. The more you lie, the more you cover up, the more trouble you get into. None of this works.
Okay? Excellent. You know, I'm very excited myself to see how all of the modern teachings of the Christian theologians and all these things and all these missionaries who are trying to incorporate things from the Old Testament, like you mentioned earlier, like the Akedah and so many other things that are never even mentioned in the Gospels,
right,
never.
Right. And it's like, I'm interrupting, but think for this a moment. We're told by Christians that it says in Psalm 22, they pierced my hands and my feet. Think about that. Let's think about that for a moment. So the Jews say that is a mistranslation. Psalm 22, verse 17 or 16 of the Christian Bible was changed by the church later on to read, they pierced my hands and my feet. But in fact, the original Hebrew says, Ka'ari yodei v'raglei, which means like a lion, they're at my hands and my feet. And Christians, at some stage after the advent of Christianity, probably in the second century, definitely in the second century, someone changed that text from like a lion there at my hands and my feet to they pierced my hands and my feet, okay? Christians claim the opposite. Christians say, no, no, no. Psalm 22 really always said they pierced my hands and my feet, but the Jews changed it to like a lion because they don't want you to believe in Jesus because we're in this conspiracy together. I want to ask you a question. If Psalm 22, verse 17, and again, in a Christian Bible, it appears in verse 16, always said, they pierced my hands and my feet, and that's how it read during the first century, do you really believe that Paul, whoever wrote Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, none of them mentioned that verse anywhere in the Christian Bible? Do you think for a second, if Psalm 22 said they pierced my feet, that no Christian author thought that was important enough to include that in their Gospels or in their epistles, in their letters. You know, that's nonsensical. It would be, they would have loved such a reading. It would have been flying all over the place. Matthew, in fact, had to use these ridiculous fulfillment citations. He'll be called a Nazarene. Behold, a virgin will conceive. He made up all this kind of stuff. Well, he or the community from which he was conveying. If it said that kind of stuff, don't you think, if the earliest Christians thought, or if any Jews thought that the Akedas Yitzchak was not what the Bible says? The Bible says, you know, this is the greatest test of Abraham. This was the 10th test of Avraham Avinu, Abraham, our patriarch. And the Torah says there, it means you don't have to guess. If you open Genesis 22, you'll notice that it says there at the opening of this chapter that God tested Abraham. In fact, it's the only test where the Torah announces it's a test. It's interesting. Abraham is in fact tested many times, but only on one occasion does the Torah say, this is a test. The key point is, Genesis 22 begins by saying, this is a test of Abraham's faith. That means that in order to not see that, you have to ignore the word of God. A Christian claims that Genesis 22 is foretelling that God would have a son who would die for our sins, then he really should get on the phone and call up God and say, could you please change Genesis 22? Genesis 22 announces with a full throat precisely what this chapter is devoted to, and that is testing Abraham's faith in the greatest way possible. In order to draw any other conclusion, you have to throw the Bible, its most sacred, timeless passages, in the garbage. And frankly, I'm not willing to do that. I don't know of any religious Jew who's willing to do that either.